Welcome to episode 2 of Over the Bar. I'm back at Canvey Island Rugby Club to meet the geezer that is Geezer Desmond. Before the pandemic, he said he was going to retire at 53 years old, having started playing rugby, strangely enough, at 39 years old. Let's go hear his story in Dawson. Bit of a shock, was it, to the system?
Yeah.
Just getting started?
Yeah, I'm just waking up.
Yeah, how you been?
I'm good, mate. Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, things are good. I'm, working.
So you was rowing yesterday?
Yeah, yeah. We couple of plastic kayaks, rubber kayaks that Danny got, pretty cheap. Good day, done 10 mile doing it, so yeah, good fun.
So yeah. Is that the most fitness you've done over this lockdown?
Well, with swimming being shut, yeah.
A few that's probably beers. About it.
Oh yeah, yeah. I had a couple of beers. I went out last night. Went round to White Hart because that's open. But yeah, we had a couple of beers and that. But it was nothing like amazing. It was just like, you know.
Good to see, be amongst people once again. It's a bit of socialising.
Yeah. Well, this is it in here because we're all. I mean, I've just been going to work, coming home, going to work, coming home, and not seeing anyone. You know, I've not done any work from home. I've been actually in since day one because with railways it switches to freight. So you become part of keeping the freight running, keeping it going around the country. So yeah, so I've been in every day.
So nice to get out, see a few people, have a few beers,
yeah.
Do a bit of PE, although it wasn't really, just yeah. Floating up and down the lake. Yeah,
yeah. Asking Brad for getting saved
by Brad Elwin, yeah. That's what no one wants ever, do they? To be saved by
Brad Elwin.
No, I don't need mouth-to-mouth, man. Yeah.
I went near the edge and I thought like it was a lip there, I thought it'd be okay, but then the boat started to go and he come across the same. I think at one time I said please help.
Did have a snorkel on. So we're just going to talk about your sort of life, because it's quite extraordinary sort of what happened in terms of starting to play rugby at 39 years old.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine that many people have started playing rugby at 39.
Yeah, my mother-in-law said to me, bless her, what are you doing playing your age? You know, what are you trying to prove? And I said, I'm not trying to prove anything.
No.
Unfortunately, in terms of rugby, and I've had this conversation with you and a lot of others over the years, that if I had it all again, I would just play rugby from the start.
Yeah. So let's go back to the start then. Let's just go back to when you was born. Obviously, the world was in black and white at that point.
Yeah.
There was no colour.
Yeah.
The trees were black and white. Yeah.
It's even better though.
Yeah. Well, there's many problems back then, but no. You was born. Obviously, you went to school in London, I believe.
I went to a school called Rollsville Juniors in Canning Town. Then I went on to a secondary school called Cumberland. And this is where we get to, like, in terms of rugby, because my school was the only school that didn't play rugby.
Right.
Yeah. I think the schools that surround us, like Trinity, Rokeby, Brampton and Woodside, all played rugby.
Right.
But in where I came from, it was football, and I played football every day.
Yeah.
So I went to school, played football at lunchtime. Came home to school, played football. Saturday, got up, played for the school. Played in the afternoon, got up Sunday morning, played for a football club. And then in the afternoon we played, that's all we ever did, so just played football.
So when you say you'd go back now and play rugby, you obviously enjoy playing football because you played so much of it.
Yeah. I think I fell out of love with football in like the 80s and the 90s when it started getting rich and all that, because
commercial.
I think it was like the diving and all that. It was just getting on my nerves. And I've always played sport and I've always followed rugby.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you know, because it's just one of the sports that I've always liked. You know, I even remember now, like, the 80 Grand Slam, Bill Bowman. Yeah. You know, and then watching the Lions early hours in the morning when they used to play early hours in the morning, having to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, go and watch them when they was down touring. So it was always there, but I never had the opportunity because there was, like, never really any clubs that I ever went to. So, yeah, it was quite strange.
Which is strange, isn't it? Because sort of in football terms, I think a lot of rugby players don't mind admitting that they watch a lot of football. I think more rugby players actually do watch football and support a football team more than they do watch rugby and support a rugby team.
Correct.
Whereas a football player, very rarely, you'd say, do you watch rugby the weekend? And he'd be like, what do you mean watch rugby? I want to watch football.
Yeah.
But was there sort of different in that? Would you?
Yeah, well, I never had a rugby club. No. I mean, I never supported a rugby club. I just used to watch rugby. And then when it came around to actually, you know, picking a club to, you know, that you wanted to support, I could have gone quite easy with the Wasps and the Harlequins and all that, like, you know. So my granddad was from Northampton.
Oh, okay.
So I started.
Which wasn't a bad choice, isn't it? No, I don't know why,
didn't I? Yeah. So I started supporting Northampton as a rugby club, and I've been there a few times, and so that became my club. But you're right, you have, like, as a football player and a fan. Yeah. Like West Ham, I mean, where I grew up, and I used to walk to West Ham's football ground every weekend. But rugby club?
No.
I didn't have a rugby club. Didn't have it at all.
So how did you get into rugby and what age? So go back, let's go back. What sort of level of football did you play? Let's talk about
it. I was just under semi-pro standard.
It was a decent standard.
I played in the Essex Business Houses. I played in the senior immediate league. Of the Essex Business Houses, and it was a Saturday league, proper, you know, it was really, really good standard football. And we played at Averley. You know, over at Averley, there's a pitch, the first team pitch, or what was known as the football pitch, if a pitch can be that big in the book, that was it.
Right.
Yeah, so if a pitch had to be that long and that wide, it was that. And there was a rugby pitch next to it, which was exactly the same.
Right.
Yeah. And so, like, you know, playing on decent pitches, not having to put posts out, you know, turning up, and food and all that. But I did that for about 4.5 years at that standard. But I couldn't go the next step,
right?
Because of work.
Okay.
Yeah, because the railways before privatisation, you couldn't earn a decent living without having a work weekend.
Right.
So I had to work either a Saturday night or a Sunday.
Do you resent that a little bit?
Well, I don't know how good I could have been,
yeah.
You know, if I'm being honest. But now I think the same thing with rugby, how good I could have been, you know.
Not very good.
No.
Yeah. It doesn't matter how old you was when you started. Let me tell you now, you're going to be good at 20.
Yeah, so I've never.
You played a good level of football. And sort of, as you said, in sort of when I asked you about your backstory, you said that obviously the kids, obviously, come into play, work come into play, and you had to give that up for a couple of years.
I gave up football twice. I had to give up football when I was 15, like growth hormone.
I was small. Yeah.
When I left school, I was actually 5'5".
Right.
But your pituitary gland, which feeds your growth and that, mine had slowed right down.
Right.
So, I'd had enough, like, I said to my dad one day about it, because my dad's 6 foot, or he was, but and my brothers and my sisters were all quite tall. And there's me down there at 5'4", 5'5", and I just had the hump, and I just said, like, my dad was reading something in a paper about what they call endocrinology, and he got me to London Hospital, where I met a very distinguished gentleman with a double barrel surname, Dr. Stuart Mason, who did a load of tests on me. Got to, on a couple of weeks, and he rang up my dad and said, we've got a person with a bone structure of someone around about 5'11", 6 foot.
Yeah.
We can help him. So they did that. They started pumping me full of tablets. It was tablets first and foremost. So I used to take four of these little tablets 3 times a day. And then every month I'd get a booster injection in the thing. I don't know if it was growth hormone or what, you know, in terms of for working out and that. But, and the results were virtually immediate.
In terms of what?
Puberty.
How old was it?
15.
Yeah.
Most kids have reached puberty by then, you know. But it was instant, you know. And then in 2 years, I gained about six, seven inches in height. I went through 3 shoe sizes. So I went from a 6 to a 7 to an 8, which I'm now about between a 9 and 8 and
so
9.
So you turned into a normal person.
Yeah, I turned into a normal person. Yeah.
From where he was a little hobby, he was a normal person.
Yeah, because the growth was expanding.
Yeah.
You know, I was getting out, you know, I obviously a little bit brittle, and so I had to knock that on the upper a few years, and so I didn't play football or anything like that, you know. And then obviously the downsides of it is, like, you know, you get boils, you know, you get you know, the body, because of body changes, acne and all that, like from hell. And then it was then that I started playing again. You know, once I got a little bit more in terms of fitness and getting my fitness back. And as I say, the other time I stopped playing was when Joe came along.
So let's talk about football back then, because obviously football now, not sort of being derogatory to football players, but it's a bit tight, isn't it? It's a bit like, don't touch me.
Oh, yeah.
Football back then was a bit more physical.
Oh, yeah. So, but Saturday football was what I call proper football.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you get a tackle, but there wasn't people trying to break your legs.
No, it was hard.
Yeah.
Lobby style sort of.
Oh, yeah, you got tackled, mate. Yeah. You know, you got, like, we had a centre forward, Steve Young. Unbelievable. Just a massive big man, yeah. And the story was, we kick off, goes back with our keeper, this fellow called Dennis Murphy, and he launched one down the middle, right, straight down the middle, and Steve Owens would come running from either one corner, straight into the middle of their centre half and take him out.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that was always the start. Play, yeah. That's how we did it. And then if he was any good, you spent a lot of time being taken out. So, yeah. I mean, I used to come off like, you know, I played midfield. When I first started as a kid, you know, football in them days was... 2-3-5.
Yeah.
You know, you had a left winger, a right winger, an inside right, an inside left, and the centre. So it was like 2-3-5, and always played on the left hand side, being a left hooker. But you know, as the game started to change, I sort of like drifted into midfield because I had a pretty fit engine. You know, I could run and keep going. So like, you know, I had a little bit of skill about me. But the other thing is, I could kick with both feet.
So do you think, like, till I know you? I played rugby, I've seen you play rugby, and you are the typical sort of football rugby convert, whereas like referees, you can get hate referees, like being the loudest person on the pitch.
Yeah.
So when you're playing football, whereas that sort of thing is not accepted, but
it's accepted.
Yeah,
you can call the referee
what
a chip.
You want, yeah.
Yeah, you can call the referee.
So was that you? Just screaming and shouting?
All the time. Yeah. Rant used to be rampant. It's not good when you think about it now. You think, oh, you know, amount of times I got into trouble with refs, and basically, I mean, rugby put me in my place.
Yeah.
I think the first game I ever played, I questioned the referee's side, and then he called Danny over. He reversed the penalty, marched us back 10 yards, and said, Danny, turn to keep his mouth shut, and he's off.
And you feel bad about that, don't you?
Well, because you do think, you know,
it's just cost your team a thing.
But I've spent the rest of the last 70 years having Danny turn me shut.
Yeah, but do you think that you're sort of got the small man syndrome because of your growth?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, mate, yeah, yeah. But it highlighted that in terms of where I went, yeah, because I've always been the angry man.
Yeah, the angry man.
Yeah, I occasionally have rows on Facebook with people. You know, you're probably right, and that and the fact that I mean, like my mum and dad split up when I was a kid. I was only like, I think I was 2.5 when my mum and dad broke.
Well, but you didn't know much about it.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I do.
Do you remember?
Yeah, you remember things. Yeah. You know, like, you know. So I became a bit of an arsehole. I was a bit of an arsehole.
So was you an arsehole in school?
Yeah.
Did that sort of affect your grades and your...
Well, I didn't do well at all. I sat at school, but I didn't do well at all.
Just angry.
Yeah.
Just
scribbling
over the paper.
I was just, you know, it was just me. I got my qualifications later in life. Basically, when I grew up.
Yeah.
Yeah. At that time when I left school, I was fortunate enough to get a job as a plumber. Apprentice plumber on the railway, because we used to look after everything on the railways, all the hotels up in London and everything. So you had all this big area you could look after. So I got an apprenticeship and I passed that. So that set me on in terms of on the road. But once you get into the railway, and you can talk to railway people, once you're in the railway, sort of like it's in, and you don't leave, or you don't want to go on to something else, so you move into all different things, like, you know.
So socially,
are
you like an angry man? Like when you was younger?
Yeah.
Would you go out to pubs and flick the switch?
But I couldn't have a fight. So 9 times out of 10, I'd flick
you were just
a
bloke in the back pointing the fingers.
9 times out of 10, I'd flick a switch and get knocked out. And because that was like football. I mean, I went around the country at West Ham and knocked around some naughty, naughty people, like, you know, getting involved in football violence. That's the only reason I actually stopped going, you know, because I met Angela and... I think up third or fourth time, but this one was close, you know, could have gone away.
Right.
And that was, I got nicked at Arsenal, West Ham Arsenal. And she basically said, how much longer?
Yeah, until you're actually in prison.
Oh, yeah, how much longer? And I said to you, yeah, you're right. And I stopped, and I, you know. But
did playing football at a decent level not stop you from doing that?
What?
Sort of the antisocial behaviour, the football quirkism, if you want to call it that. Did playing football.
No, I don't think, unless you actually grow up, football's tribal. I don't think people understand it, you know. I don't think people understand in terms of what, you know, where I came from. You know, like where I lived in Kenny Town, like, you know, with all the people that were around it, because there's so many different people. Everybody was in gangs. I mean, it was gangs in out when we were kids.
Yeah.
We did have gangs. There was gangs, but not like nowadays when these kids are blowing each other away. Like postcodes.
Yeah.
But then you just migrated to football. And the same people you played, you know, football with were the same people you went to football with, you know, and then you travelled away. And the great thing for me, working on the railway, free travel in them days.
Yeah.
So I used to go all over the country. I went everywhere, like, you know, for about four... Yeah, with four seasons, you know. I mean, like, it's been there, I think. And I've always been sort of like a bit angry.
Yeah.
But you know, the last couple of years, I've really calmed down. I think that's got.
So let's now talk about rugby.
Yeah.
So Gary Desmond, we just learned, he's an angry, small man. Played a bit of football, decent level. Got kids, two kids at this point.
Yeah.
You're married.
Yep.
You meet Kev Cooper, working on the railway,
and
sort of how does it now?
Has it now manifest the rugby? Well, I'd come past it many times.
So
I knew people lived on the island in the late 80s, early 90s when I came on it, but I never thought to come over. And then me and Kev was talking about doing a railway side.
Right.
So we did a railway side called the East Anglia Railway Barbarians, you know, so we got up. And he said, "You fancy playing?" I said, "Yeah." So we formed this side. There was me and Keith Hatter. Keith, he was playing. He was the other one, and the other fellow signed. So it was four of us who set it all up.
So why did you fancy playing? When you'd been playing football for that time.
Yeah.
Why did Kev come up to you and say, "You fancy playing rugby?" And this, why did you then go, "Yeah, right?"
I don't know. I think it's because I always wanted to.
Yeah.
I think it's because I always wanted to, and I thought, yeah. And then I thought, I'll give it a go. And we had our first game. I think we played over against Canvey. And I remember getting home that night and I was sitting there and I couldn't get my head off my chest. It just kept going like that, you know, because it was a shock to the body. And then I got up next morning, I was bits and pieces walking, and I was walking to the bathroom, and Andrew said to me, "So is that your rugby career over?" Yeah. And I went, love it.
So did you understand the laws of the game?
I followed it, mate. Yeah. I followed it, you know. I followed it, and then the first time I ever played, I think I played fly off, and within 5 minutes, I didn't know where I was
going.
Like,
to be fair, for someone to start, it might be fly off a pretty integral part.
Go
and play fly off,
Cap. Yeah, well, that's when the opportunity came to play scrum off.
Yeah.
The angry man came out. Yeah. I thought,
that's my position. Yeah.
That's what I want. You know,
either hooker or scrum off.
I didn't think I was ever going to be a forward. And I've never pushed weights, and it's never been sort of like part of me to do things like that. But I thought I could do the scrum half.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I was angry enough to play scrum half. And I liked, to be honest, I liked hanging around with the forwards. So I was always with
real
the
men.
Forward. Yeah.
Yeah, drinking, real blokes, yeah.
Drinking and talking with the real men in the game. So yeah, that's how it came about. And it was only after I had a knee operation that I'd done nothing for a couple of years.
This is what I was going to ask you. So you played football and you've had a knee on, which is giving you a bit of ache.
Yeah.
Kept going, do you want to play rugby?
Yeah.
And what age are you now?
I'm 39.
So you're 39 years old?
This is 38 now.
You're 38? You've got a dodgy neck.
No, this one was, at the time it'd been operated on, so I'd had it done, it was okay. But then this started playing up, I had this one done in 2012.
Yeah.
Left one done in 2012 while I was still playing rugby. Then this one started to play up, and then I went in there to look at it again to see if it was more damage, and he said, "No, it's not, it's arthritis." So for all that time, I thought my cartilage was problems. He said, "No, it's arthritis." So my pain, or the jit that this gives me, is arthritis. But I overdose on BB, as anyone that's, you know, I'm in the dressing
room.
Pat Rowe thinks I own shares. So, you know, I came over and I played, and I was instantly taken with... not just the social side, but people.
Yeah.
You know, I remember meeting you the first time. I think you pissed up my leg in the shower. And
just your leg?
Yeah.
I must have been dehydrated.
I was wondering, I was thinking, what do I do now? What am I going to do now?
Yeah, this angry bloke. Yeah. He's now getting pissed under the shower.
Someone else, you're like an angry bloke.
He's accepted it, yeah. And even angrier bloke is now pissing at me.
Yeah, but there's a difference. The rugby blokes, you know, it's getting knocked out, but getting smashed up by rugby blokes. But, and I fell in love with the place. I enjoyed the people, the company. I've met friends for life. I mean, I've got two people here who are like as close to me as family in Dan.
So what year is this? I think
this is 2003.
So England had just won the World Cup. Before the World Cup.
It was just before the World Cup.
Just before the World Cup.
I came over. I missed the 2002 season when Kev. So he said, well, you might not bother. So I came back in and did the training through the pre-season. Remember being run over by Dunny. Jesus. Not knowing how to tackle, learning how to tackle. Without a doubt, yeah. And then going to the games and playing your first game and getting, my old man was watching his other Victoria Park. We was playing Millwall at Victoria Park. Very first away game I ever played. And I got caught on the wrong side of a ruck. And my old man said to Angela, look at a rack of geezer rats. They're almost going. And for years I'd have scarred that, but it was probably Gary Bird.
Yeah, it's probably your own class. Yeah. It was Danny, Gary Bird, someone else, yeah.
Yeah, I used to run when I saw him coming down. Yeah, I used to just run the other way in case he'd run into me.
I remember being in a mall and setting the ball back and Gary Bird coming to secure the ball. He didn't secure the ball. It was like he was tackling me.
Yeah.
He just dove in head first and just smashed me.
Yeah,
he did have no clue. Well-being of his own players.
He gets trampled on with
him. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I don't know what boots he was wearing. Yeah. They must be the biggest boots in the world because he always had a tag from Gary Bird.
I think he's one of life's
characters.
Yeah. Massive character, Gal. Yeah. But as I say, you could not want it, mate. I mean, I come over here in the after the games and watch the drink, all the beer drink, which I used to get actively involved in.
Yeah.
All the beer drinking games, and then I remember a merit table game, shirt and tie. And I went shirt and tie. Yeah. I said, wear shirt and tie all week. Yeah. I don't want to wear anything. But once I actually put it on,
you feel part of
the club, and I think the difference between rugby and football as well, Brett. I'm being honest. That's like going to war, isn't it?
Yeah, of course.
With football.
You're going over the top.
And when you go out with the people on the pitch, they sort of like become brothers.
Yeah.
Even if
you don't like them.
Oh, yeah.
While still on the pitch.
There's a few people I would like to stamp below.
Oh, he's getting beat up.
I'd run and, stamp on him. Yeah. On a game, I don't care whether I like them or not. I'm going to go flying in. Because that's what you do as a club.
As a club, because he's got to wash the shirt on that you're wearing. Yeah.
Yeah, but it was strange because, as I said, I totally fell in love with it, mate. Yeah. I was co-opted on the committee in 1 year.
Yeah.
I know that. I mean, when I said to Angela, I'm on the committee, co-opted on the committee. She said, "What, really?" So I said, "Yeah, So and then 2 years later, I'm secretary.
Yeah.
Because I did a year under John Anderson was secretary. I was assistant secretary. And in 2007, I became sector.
Right.
And that lasted till 14, even though it says up there till 13, I need a world.
Something's going wrong, yeah.
I think Len thinks it goes to January to December, but a season goes. So the last thing I did was the AGM in 2014, so he owes me a digit on the end of that.
So I'm not even 39 yet, and I've been playing rugby for 25 years, and people keep saying, when are you retiring?
Yeah.
Which I don't have no fucking reasons in doing at all.
No.
But so you started playing rugby. After leaving, I'm still playing.
Yeah.
So what state was the club in when you come to the club?
It was just starting to come back. There was three teams.
It was three teams.
That was the first. It was just starting to come back. I think the year before, it was where it was a little bit fraught. Yeah. And then your dad and Jeff did a third team.
Yeah.
I thought I was coming over to play threes, but I walked it. I played twos. And they'll use Alex, Brunwell and all them, Del Boy. You was starting to make your mark as the ones.
Yeah.
And there was still a lot of these more older heads where you like BA and that, and all that, yeah. And so the club was in a really good, starting to get in a really good place.
That was a good time to turn up.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, the next 4 years.
Yeah.
Was just unbelievable. We, in the twos, we went up so many, we went up League after league after league, we won games we never know right to win.
Let's talk about your first game. Your first game for Canvey. First time you pulled on the shirt.
Yeah.
Can you remember who was against, what the score was? How you felt?
No, I don't, mate. I remember the first away games got trodden all over. But no, I don't remember the first game. But I remember feeling really, really good. Really, really, you know, thinking like, you know, I've made the mark and I'm walking here now, you know, you've got people in here, you know, who are your mates now, who like become your friends. And that's the other thing I'll say, like, I won't be anywhere, you know, in a pub or something, bump into one of a Canvey board. And even more now so much because I play with other players and you play with other players, people you play with become friends with you as well, which doesn't happen in football either.
Let's talk about the sort of bar culture of rugby. Like sort of what do they do? I know, like, obviously there's some quite nasty things that go on inside this clubhouse, but sort of what does it differ from sort of the football, say the football social side of it? What's the difference?
Football was play the game, have a couple of drinks, have a go out.
That's it.
That was it. You know, the only time you used to let go is if you'd organise a night out with each other, but not in the club.
No.
It was if you wanted to do something like, you know, go and have a drink, or if it was the end of season presentation. But after most games, we had a lovely big clubhouse at Italy, and we would just sit in there and have a couple of drinks, you know, after the game. Some wouldn't even drink, drink, and then go on. Yeah. That was it. There was nothing like this. It was a complete eye opener for me.
So when you did see what was going on in here, it might not have been your first game, but then obviously like throughout the season, some stuff started happening. Did you think, fuck it, this is a bit close to the mark? Or did you think, fuck, I'm just
going to
get involved here?
I was there, mate.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, I'd have been down to my pants and everything.
Baby oiled up.
Yeah, yeah, it wouldn't bother me.
Yeah, just things inserting.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was sort of thinking when I see some of the things going on, but it's a bit of a raised eyebrow, but like, you know, you just...
And it didn't put you off at all? No. It's just like, this is what...
No, it gets passed off, doesn't it? You know, because the one thing, there was never kids here.
Yeah,
it was just all us, you know, just acting the goat, like, you know what I mean?
I was about to say it's done out of respect, but it ain't respectful, is it?
It's not respectful at all. No. And we had that turned out to be one of the great things about the club.
Did that keep you playing more than the rugby?
Yeah. Oh.
The social stuff.
Yeah, I didn't want to go home. I didn't want to go home. I wanted to get and I couldn't wait for Saturday to come. But the moment I walked out the door, I wanted to come training because until my knee really started playing up. I was always training, you know, even as old as I was getting like in the 40s, 50s, and I'm still training.
Yeah.
And I like training. And I look around and at some of the boys now and I think, you're not doing yourself any favours. You're not doing yourself any favours. Like, you know, have a bit of personal responsibility and respect for yourself, to get fit, you know. And otherwise, I never drank on a Friday, ever, when I played football. Even like when I was playing rugby here. Never drunk on a Friday.
No.
I used to say to the boys when they come in on a Saturday morning before the game looked a bit bleary, I said, What are you doing? Get drunk tonight. Don't go out Friday nights. You know, you've got to, you know, have a game like that. But it was, that kept me going.
So?
There's only one year, mate, I felt really, really, really thinking we got promoted to BL2, Merits over 2. And that was just a step up. That was a step to the top. Yeah, because people went down. Yeah. That was a year, mate. That the threes were actually stronger than the twos, and I actually think that was not a very good thing. And when you're getting dicked like 104-0 at West Cliff, 100-odd-0 at
Barton, you kept turning up.
And this is it. But this is why I have a lot of respect for the likes of Lanza and Steph and Craig Nash, because there's only kids.
They was there,
and every week we got, you know, we got turned over or we got dicked.
So yeah, you come for football. And sort of your personality isn't an introvert.
No, I don't get on introvert.
No, it's very loud and very boisterous.
Yeah.
And sort of, so when you're on the pitch, you like expressing yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Not just through physicality, but through your vocal cords.
Yeah.
They're not. So some players thinking this bloke has been playing rugby for 5 fucking minutes.
Shut up.
He's fucking an OAP, why is he telling me what to do?
Yeah.
Do you sometimes think that causes a bit of conflict between your teammates when you fucking go, I'm fucking the same, Yeah, as you well know. I don't mind seven plays, what to do.
I've never heard anyone tell me to shut up. No, don't say nothing. You know, I mean, Jay, you get, you know, it's, there's people talk, certain people, you listen. But I mean, I don't think I was, I was very vocal in terms of trying to get the team up. But I don't remember ever, you know, making people say, "Why don't you shut up?" For fuck's sake, you know, I used to row with Danny a lot, but to be honest, you know, because I'd always say something to a ref, and Danny would say something, and then me and him would be going at it. I mean, George Cunningford walked in the bar one day, he said, "Them two hate each other."
They don't know.
Each other, yeah. You know, but yeah, I mean, I was never ever not going to be vocal, but once you start to understand how people play, you then temper down.
I start off really fucking up for it, and vocal, and as soon as the ref says shut up or you're going, you're going to be with 10 minutes, you don't say a fucking thing for the rest of the game, because you know that you're going to get tempted. Yeah.
Now, I do that usual football thing of talking about it, but it's one of the like, I don't have a lot of time. Don't have a word with him. Harry missed that one, you know what I mean? Do it in front of him.
In earshot of him,
so you do that sort of thing. But, and I spent a couple of years just keeping your mouth shut. Literally, keeping your mouth shut.
Yeah, and that must be fucking hard.
I got player of the year, 53.
Yeah. Now, I did that for 53 years old.
53, yeah, you tell me.
Players' Club?
Yeah, 53.
And what?
That was a year after winning the John Adler Trophy, so doing the triple.
You won the triple
the year before.
Probably like the best second team for a long time.
Yeah.
You're at 53?
53.
You've won players' player.
Yeah.
Like, that must have been like massive for you.
There's only one thing that tops it, mate. You know, there's only one thing that tops that. It's been, I mean, the stacks side from when I first came over, yeah, should have won some of them games, you know.
Yeah.
They should have won some of them trophies, but we never seemed to go in for them. But this one, when we won this, I mean, we did that, and, you know, we had people coming back off injuries. So, I mean, Tommy Gill played, you know, bless him. And he's three players on the pitch, mate.
Yeah,
Tommy. We had little Nick, who played scrum half. He'd been injured for a while. But it was the nucleus of the team had played all season. And then, you know, to beat Chelsea 2 in the final. Unreal, mate. You know, absolutely unreal. Brilliant, great. And then the following years, I've got players player. I've got players player in the year we was getting dicked and all, which lives, you know, also lives long in the memory. Because I think it's because I care, I give a fuck.
This is what I was about to say. It's like, you're 54 at this point. You're getting dicked every week.
Yeah.
Like, you don't need to be playing.
No.
If you said, well, I ain't fucking playing this, no one would go, oh, Gary, you're a bit of a prick.
Yeah.
Like, they'd be like, right, yeah, look.
Yeah.
So why did you carry on? Like, as I say, you care, but that's sort of like just blanketing, was it? Why did you care so much?
Because I'm still fit enough to do it.
Yeah, but you're still getting dicked.
Yeah,
but you could have gone somewhere else.
No. I would never play for another rugby club, ever. Ever. No. You know, not because I would have done if I'd been younger, like a football team. But you try and get better at what you do, and you did it. You bettered yourself. You went to another club, proved it by being, you know, player's player. I think you did 2 years on top of it. So, but no, because I came over to Canvey so late, you know, I would never play for another club. You know, so it was, this is the only club that I've got. You know, so obviously I played Essex Bishops, which is a bit like vet side. But no, if we haven't got a game, I might go and run out for a two, but I would never put any money into a club or, like, you know, subs and all that, you know, just steps around. This is my club.
Great. So let's talk about your first team. This is unbelievable that we're here. I'm about to say to you, let's talk about your first team debut. It's just crazy.
Yeah.
We're talking about starting playing rugby at 39.
Yeah.
And then, but I suppose Canvey Rugby Club being Canvey Rugby Club, it's still not unbelievable, is it? Because it's just the way the club goes sometimes.
No.
So what age are you when you
52.
Get asked to play first team?
52.
So you're 52 years old.
Yeah.
Let's talk about sort of how you got asked in. Was it sort of like going in the first team?
No. It was in a bad way. I mean, you'd gone, Scott Wheeler had gone, the other fella had gone. So it was just, you know, it was a bare bones.
Yeah.
We still had Johnny B, you know, oh God, he was in my house. John Edwards, and a few, Danny Gilliatt and a few others. And it was last game of the season, and I was speaking to Danny on the phone. She, the ones are struggling for blood for the weekend at Braintree. I said, I'll play.
Yeah.
And it was just like, we want me to tell him. I said, yeah, I'll play. I love it.
Yeah.
And I got a phone call, Braintree away, so-and-so. I said, all right, yeah, I'll go straight there. And when I got there, I walked in the dressing room, the old man came up, and he just said to me, like, you know, well done for volunteering.
Yeah.
Because he used to just put me in my place every time I was sitting at the bar. I was talking about rugby, and he'd go, well, you wouldn't know, Green, I played first team rugby, and I used to think.
Yeah.
You know, and but he came up and he
was
said,
that sort of...
I wanted to do it.
Oh, you wanted, yeah.
I had to do it.
You've had this little niggle in your backside.
Yeah, I had to do it, yeah. And then it was about 25 minutes ago, and Rob said, do you want to go on? I said, yeah, please.
So what's the score at this point?
Oh, we're getting beat. We're not getting dick. I mean, Johnny B and Rob, Johnny Edwards had combined to score a try.
Yeah.
And it was holding our own the second half. We were getting beat.
And both teams were like sort of popping up in the promotion.
Yeah, and they were like, a big old lump sort of thing. So I went on, and Johnny B came over and said, do you want to go at 9? Because he was playing. And I said, no, you stay at 9. I'll go at 15. That's what I've been playing. I'll go at 15. So I ran on the pitch, and then they broke down and left, and I thought, oh, God. I came across, and I just wiped this winger out.
Yeah.
I caught him up. I went under his arm, but it came up and went round his head, and I got penalised for that. But in the time that I was on, they didn't score. Yeah. And then it was all over.
Yeah.
It was that quick.
25 minutes.
It was that quick. So it was like, run on the pitch, one tackle, or, you know, clear a couple of lines, and then it was all over.
So what was the what would you say the main differences? I know sort of Canvey was struggling at that point, and playing first team now is probably nothing like what he was then. But from third to second to first team, what's the differences in faster, more physical?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, I would. The only closest I've come to that was Merritt Taylor 2, when we were playing Westcliff 2, which the year before were allegedly a lot of them were Westcliff 1.
Right, okay.
So it brought a lot in.
Yeah, brought a lot.
And then Barking, I don't know whether Barking was their development disorder, whether it was Barking 2s, but you know, the physicality, the tackles.
Yeah.
Yeah, the tackles are over, the pace of the game. And there's people, you know, thinking of, and I think a lot of it is you haven't got time to do anything. No. You're playing your own position, whereas in the 2s,
you're playing multiple positions.
Correct, and in the 3s, you're playing with 15. Yeah. You know, but it was on another scale. And then when I walked off, and I was sitting in the dressing room, the old man came up, and he said this to me, because I mean, I don't know whether it's, he said, I think you're the oldest one ever to debut for the month.
Yeah.
I said,
oh yeah, it's got to be, isn't it?
So I said to him, really? I said, I'm not really thought about it, but yeah, it's nice.
So even though you did get beat that day, like, don't matter.
Grace.
You fought on the ones.
Biggest knockout ever.
Never done it again?
Never.
So your debut, your last game.
Oh, yeah.
First game, your last game.
I didn't get me six or seven games, so I'll get
didn't
me tight.
Did get your call up, no.
Because I think you all started coming back
before. Yeah, the year after, yeah.
And then, I never got me tight, but it's 25 minutes of rugby in 17 years is my greatest honour.
So there's a photo, actually, for after that game. Yeah, as you say, it's you, Johnny B. I think Johnny B's got his face smashed up as he's on.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, and I think Kirby played, Alex Hurdle
played,
Rob Hundy. And it's a group, it's obviously a team fight. I think Rob Edwards was coach.
Yeah, he was coach, yeah.
And that photo, if you said, do you reckon these boys won or lost on that day? You would probably say, it looks like that was a good day. So probably won that game. Because it looks like it was all right, man. There's blokes landing, I think some of those nuts out.
That picture, there's a bit in there at the end of the whistle where, you know, most of the times I'm usually frowning that we've lost.
I know, but you've got inside, face, yeah.
You know, I'm inside, you know, you just want to burst because, you know, what's the biggest achievement? Playing for your own club, your own first team, you know. And, you know, all the things we did, even the triple.
Yeah.
Yeah. The 2 years, the playing in the Meritoma 2, the winning the players' player of the year's twat, you know, in two doesn't top it. Nothing.
You're right. I know. Well, someone played first team this year, debut, come from another club, won't mention their names, and I texted his mate and I said, he spoke to him about playing first team, like, after the game. And he said, what do you mean? I said, like, have you asked him how he feels, like, about playing first team? Why are you so interested? And I said, well, look, this is not me being fucking beginning. I played first team for that long. Like, I love fucking hearing about blokes playing first team.
Yeah.
Because, like, how they feel and what it means to them. Because
yeah.
I was chucked in for the first team.
Yeah.
Pretty much the same as you was.
Yeah.
But just the other end of the scale. Yeah, I was chucked in there, yeah. But so I never had time to take it all in. So, like, sort of that emotion of playing first team for your club. So yeah. I never had it. Because it was just like, I'm getting fucking dicked.
Yeah.
So, like, for someone to come into the first team in a winning side,
yeah.
I like knowing that it means something to
yeah.
me. So, like, but, like, for you, even coming into the first team at 53 and
yeah.
getting dicked, it still
yeah.
means something to you.
Yeah. Oh, just, about, yeah, just yeah. Because, you know, it's like, you know, with the club, I went on the committee because I wanted to do something for the
yeah.
club. You know, I enjoyed the... doing all the committee work, I enjoyed being over it. The only, you know, obviously being now diagnosed with celiac disease, I can't do the drinking games anymore
yeah.
because obviously you have to drink dirty pints and all that, right? You know, which I used to drink, yeah, I loved it.
The best thing about no smoking in the clubs was you couldn't get a dirty ashtray in your
yeah.
Because I remember doing dirty ashtrays and they are disgusting.
I know.
Drinking
yeah.
a dirty
I remember
ashtray.
The talk tour with all the dirty food, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I didn't, which I didn't, you know, I didn't used to understand that one. That was one of the things I didn't understand. And then one day you just, you know, you've got to drink it down, and then like you're drinking dog ends and
yeah.
things like that, like, you know, just get into the moment. But no, I enjoyed it. And I only left the committee. I mean, there was a few things going on. And then I also needed to stand down because I'd just been put in charge of a big overhead manager.
Yeah.
It was it taking a lot of my time up. And so I couldn't do that and then commit to this, you know. So I knocked it on the head. But yeah, I'll probably, you know, when the time's right, I'll probably come back, you know, because this is the sort of club where
yeah.
it totally relies on its volunteer.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I think what we're going through now is just brilliant, you know. I think it's absolutely brilliant, mate. The kids are now over here, what you see going on, what you've all done, you know. And I know he don't like the limelight, but Al,
yeah.
you know, he's done marvellous, mate. And he should be proud of what he's done.
Yeah, I think he is.
Yeah.
So, you was going to retire this year, but obviously yeah. we're talking about
yeah.
you went into a pandemic, moving from plans.
Yeah.
So what's your plans now? You're still going to retire? You're going to
get
that last game in? You've got to get that last game in.
I'm still playing. I'm still going to play. We made a thing to retire from the twos.
Right.
Not play twos rugby. I can't do twos rugby.
No.
But yeah. So with the threes now kicking off, like, and playing a few games.
Once a month or something. Like
yeah.
That.
And then playing vets. Yeah.
So you're not retiring. You just.
No, I'm retiring from the twos.
Yeah. It's not retiring at all,
no,
is it?
No, you don't retire at all.
No.
Yeah. Like, you know. And but if I'm honest, part of me was going to call it done.
Yeah.
Right the way down the line, and just say no, enough. But while I'm still fit enough, you know, obviously I've got to take account of the arthritis and knee, and it gives me some jip afterwards and during the week and that. But I supplement not being out of train by swimming.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the other thing where I say about personal fitness and, you know, a little bit of respect for yourself. So, you know, I swim as much as I can, not at the moment because the pools are shut. So I started swimming about 8-9 years ago, and I regularly swim 3 nights a week, 2 miles at a time.
Which is quite fucking knackered too, isn't it?
Yeah. It's very knackered. It's very boring after a while.
Yeah.
You know,
it's
once
like
you start,
you're sort of
yeah,
it makes your own faults
yeah.
instead of being.
Yeah, yeah, and that's how you get through it.
Yeah.
You know, so you know you think, you know, and I've had quite a lot to think about, you know. So you get when I'm swimming, I sort of like just. You know, just shut off and get in the zone. The most I've ever swam in one big hit is about 3.5 miles.
Mm.
You know, but I just went up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down a little bit. You know, there's some days I think,
yeah, it sounds fucking boring.
I can't be bothered. I can't be bothered. But you go,
yeah.
You know, because it's in your in like someone like me, it's in my psyche
yeah.
to go. You know, and same as people who turn up training all the time in all weathers.
Mm.
You know, filthy rain and snow. But they're always the same people.
Yeah.
And you can count on your hand really good, but
yeah.
every single time.
The mentality, yeah. Yeah.
And that would be me.
Yeah.
You know, as a young man, I love the training, I love getting involved in everything.
So. Yes, you don't do nothing high. It's all in or not at all.
Everything. It's like, you know, with the band, I mean, I started doing the band in 92, just before Jada was born. And see, that's like 28 years now of doing that. But I still rehearse.
Yeah.
Like I am, you know, when we go rehearsals, it's you know, we, you know, go full on.
So let's talk about the band, because obviously it does band nights over here.
Yeah.
Well, how do they compare to your standard pub? Obviously, we've had
some. Yeah, on form. Yeah, on form.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
You get an on form night in here, mate. And you know, there's. It's another level.
I know you quite like it,
yeah.
Because you know people in here, but when the band's here and you've got people trying to play guitar and trying to fucking nick the drumsticks off them, and obviously we're all jumping on the mic, yeah. How do they feel about that?
Well, the guitarists are very thingy about their gear.
Their kit, yeah.
I mean, Keith, whose band it is and who's been there from the start, he's got a lorry load of money down on the floor, and when people like, you know, jumping around or stamping on it or like, yeah, they don't see it, they don't see it very good. But when, you know, like, when they see me all climbing up the rafters and you know, and jumping up and down and things like that, mate, it's just it's great. I love it. I'll jump up and down and do it myself.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's a few pubs we're getting, you know, as we're getting older, and as it's getting thinner, we seem to be getting better gigs and more.
So no sort of provisions in giving that up at all? Just want to keep going?
A couple of years, I think. Yeah. Yeah, I'm not going to be doing it when I'm 60.
No.
No, I'm not going to jump up on stage and start singing.
Like, literally, Canvey's Mick Jagger.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not going to start dying the air when I'm about that. Like, you know, but it's...
how's life going to be for Geezer Desmond, this fucking like angry vocal singer who's like, he's got no rugby, he's got no fucking band to play with? Like, what are you going to do? Just headbutting walls in your living room? Have you calmed down?
I've a 2.5-year-old girl was getting brought me patients, believe it or not. You know,
the 2.5-year-old girl that was yours.
I was never there. I was always working. Yeah. I was always there.
Yeah.
So I'd come home, but they'd be asleep. And I'd go and work and they'd be asleep. Yeah. And that was everything. And then, you know, when you then come home on a Saturday and you then go football, and then you come home Saturday night and then you go out with a band and then you go and work Sunday, that's when it becomes selfish.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so something had to give. I knew I was earning money out of band. I wasn't earning anything playing football. So unfortunately, football had to go.
Yeah.
And so I was always there at the weekend. One of the, you know, so if I did a Saturday night, it was good. So all day Saturday, I'd sleep after a night shift anyway, so I'd be there all day Sunday. So that changed when I was a little bit older. Yeah. But in the early days, I was never there.
Yeah.
And obviously with this one, she's always there.
Yeah.
You know, so I found a patience to be able to sit there and do things with her and play things with her. And like when she's in a mode,
what's the difference in being a dad and a granddad? Obviously, this is just opinion.
Dad and granddad?
What's the difference in having a young...
Well, it used to be years ago, you let them go.
Yeah.
But I don't let her go now, because she lives in my house. So, I think it's time.
You've got more time now?
Yeah. I think that's what it is. I think because I've got more time than I did have, I didn't really, you know, appreciate it.
Yeah.
I didn't appreciate it. And I think that is the problem with society, right? Because, you can't both not go to work.
That's right.
Because everything is too dear.
Yeah, everything's too expensive.
And the way...
Cost of living is just ridiculous.
Oh, it's ridiculous, mate. You know, women, the greatest job in the world is being a mother, as far as I'm concerned. You know, a mother and a homemaker. Andrew was fortunate that I went and worked some silly hours to make sure she could stay home with the girls, you know, and not many people get that luxury, you know, and you know, it's paid out, you know, it's turned out well, you know, as well as a couple.
Is that worth yourself, isn't it?
No, it's been good, mate, and I think between grandfather and a father, it's just more time.
Yeah.
You know, I'm still the same with like, not the girls and that, but I've got more time to sit down, more time to, you know, to, teach things with her and play with her and all that, like, you know. So yeah, it's good.
So obviously, before we wrap up, let's just talk about the characters that you've met in rugby. So if you just want to sort of list a few of them and just talk about, I mean, just to paint the spectrum, because obviously we've got to talk about them. This is your life.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have to go through a fucking whole team, but.
Well, I picked the Stacks. I did pick a Stacks all-time great, as it goes, that I thought.
I'm not worried about
there is
best
character.
Players. Let's talk about the characters. Like, you've
Jeff
Burler,
Munch. Jeff Burler, Munch. Learned so much off of them in the seasons that I played with them. And knocking around with them. The Killies, yeah. Danny. There's a character there, yeah. You know, we all know what he's like. You know, he's born and bred Canvey, you know, does everything, you know, we did in the early days for the club and that, like, you know. And always, you know, he's always there. He's a, you know, head case. Yourself, you're another character that I always have a laugh with and look up with and look up to. Kev, because he got me over here, yeah. And it hadn't been bringing me over here, I wouldn't have met people that have now become, yeah, you know, friends for life.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of rugby players, I still play with Jason. He still plays at you know, and he's another person who you listen to and you can learn from, and you know, and as someone who plays rugby and with kids, you want a role model to look up to, how to look after yourself.
Yeah.
There it's there in spades, you know, and then obviously you've got the Loonies who come over like your Brian Boyles.
Yeah.
Del Boy.
Yeah.
You know, there's so many.
There's so many.
There is so like many characters over here, like your dad. You know, he's, bless him. He's, you know, it's just, it's a great place to be. And there's some great, great people in here.
Yeah.
And I always, you know, as long, you know, until the day I fall off the perch, I'll be coming over here. Yeah.
Well, Gal, thanks for coming out on Sunday afternoon.
Yeah, no problem.
Normally, when you're playing in the band, I'll fucking jump up and nick the mic off you and probably nudge you to the side a little bit, even though I can't sing for fucking.
You can have that, mate, all the time.
Can we do a song before we go?
Of course we can.
Yeah?
Yeah, of course we can. Come on. Of course we can.
So, Gav, normally I'm nudging you out of the way.
Yep.
Nicking the mic off you. You're actually allowing me to sing with you this time.
Yeah.
Let's hope it goes all right, because I've had one beer, but normally I've had about four. You ready?
I wanna know, have you ever seen the rain?
Thank you very much, Gal. Well, thank you for coming over. Thank you for the interview. Thank you for letting me see the club, which hopefully now, right?
Yeah, lovely.
No, thank you, mate. Thank you very much. See you later.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this episode of Over the Bar. I hope you enjoyed it. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Check us out on Facebook, Instagram or Twitter. Or if you'd like to go to our website, details are here. If you're a part of the rugby community and would like to be interviewed by Over the Bar, leave a comment below. Thank you and I'll see you on the other side.